Everyone knows the Bradford pear, but do you know its evil cousin, the Callery pear? If you stick with us for a few minutes, you'll know how to identify these trees, what you can do about them, and what you can do to be a good land steward. Hi, my name is Dave Coyle. I'm an invasive plant specialist at Clemson University, and my team and I have been working on the biology and management of Bradford and Callery pear for years.
The Bradford pear is Callery pear, just without the forks.
I work on invasive species because I care about our land and I want to be a good land steward. And as I drive across the southeast and I drive across these roads and throughout these countrysides and the urban landscapes, I see so many non-native plants. And a lot of times these non-native plants are not really providing any benefits. And so I do a lot of this work because I'm trying to remove these invasive plants and help people that own the land and manage the land get native stuff back in there so we can have a more fully functioning natural environment. Let's talk about how to identify Callery and Bradford pear. Probably the number one thing people notice are the flowers. These little five-petaled things, they come out in clusters. Both Callery pear and Bradford pear have these clusters of flowers. They will start blooming usually about late February through March throughout the southeast. Callery pear, though, has these really, really sharp thorns. They're called spurs at the end of this little shoot. This is the one thing Bradfords do not have, and these are sharp enough to poke through a tractor tire and pop it. There's a couple other things in the southeast that also have white flowers, but they look fairly different from Callery pear. Chickasaw plum is one of these plants that has those white flowers, but it grows as a shrub, maybe 4, 6, 8 feet tall. The flowers themselves, while white and blooming at the same time as Callery pear, are much smaller in terms of their size. I've got a Callery pear right here, Chickasaw plum right here, and so when you look up close, they're quite different. But again, these are two of the more common blooming white flowery things we have in the southeast this time of year. The other thing with white flowers you might see in the southeast is a black cherry. Now, those don't have clusters of flowers, they have longer inflorescences, and they're usually going to bloom a little bit later than Callery pear. But all of these trees can be differentiated by the trunk. Callery pear has kind of a gnarly, twisted trunk. It's got a big one here that twists up to the top, and there's often a lot of different shoots that come either right off the base of this trunk, or in this case, just a few inches off this big feeder root. We talked about Bradford and Callery pear in their identification, and they are the same species. So let me explain what's going on here. Both Bradford and Callery pear are Pyrus Calleriana. Pyrus Calleriana was brought over here from Asia in the early 1900s to confer disease resistance to the European pear, Pyrus communis, which is the one we use to produce food. This worked. We have food producing pears. Great. But some of the plantings that were put in that were the Pyrus Calleriana plantings became really good looking for horticultural trees. And one particular selection was lollipop shaped, pretty flowers, no thorns, disease resistant, bug resistant, drought resistant, and they named it the Bradford, the cultivar Bradford. And this is where Bradford pears come from. Now, Bradford pears by themselves cannot reproduce. They're called self-incompatible, so that tree can't pollinate itself and can't make fertile seeds. However, once there gets to be all sorts of other cultivars on the landscape, or once some of the wild ones start growing, then you've got pollen of all these different pyrus flying around, and all of these things can now produce viable seeds. And this is why anytime in the spring in the southeast you drive down the road, you see white flowers in the ditches, in old fields, in forests, and this is why we have a Callery pear problem. So you're probably wondering, what can I do if I have a Bradford or Callery pear on my property? Good news, plenty of options. If you've got a Bradford pear in your yard, there are a number of states that have remove and replace programs. These programs typically will ask you to remove that Bradford pear, tell them about it, show them a picture, and then you can get a free native replacement tree. Also, at this point, most people recognize that these trees are not great, and most reputable nurseries are just not going to sell them anymore. If you're trying to get rid of trees in a natural area or somewhere where it's not just a yard setting, there's a number of options there too. If they're small enough to where you can safely spray a foliar herbicide, you can do that. These trees are not indestructible. They can be killed with herbicides, and herbicides, when used according to the label, work great. If you've got trees that are larger, you've got really three main options. If your tree is small enough in diameter to where you can scrape that bark and see some green, you might be able to use what's called a basal bark herbicide application. If you see green on that bark, that means the bark is still semi-permeable, and there's some herbicides you can spray on the bark. They'll soak in, go to the roots, kill the tree and kill the roots. That means you won't have any resprouts, the tree will die, but there will still be a dead standing tree in its place. One other option, if your tree is a little bit larger like this one, where you can't scrape that bark and see green, is called a hack and squirt application. In this case, we take a hatchet, make a series of incisions around this stem, squirt herbicide in there, and then that also goes into the roots, kills the tree. Again, you've got a standing dead tree. Your final option is a cut stump application of herbicide where you cut this tree at the base, spray the herbicide on that stump, and presto, the tree is gone. You want to do this at least from summer through winter when the tree is moving both nutrients and water up and down. If you do it in the springtime, the tree is pushing everything up and it's just going to push your herbicide out and your treatment won't work. Now, if you've cut your Bradford pear tree down, great, but you're only halfway there. It has to be treated with herbicide or else you'll be left with all these stump sprouts on every root that's anywhere close to the top of the ground. Now you know how to identify and manage both Bradford and Callery pear. Fortunately, it's not that hard. Best of luck to you on your journey to being a good land steward.